So we're here in Mark 6:31. Let me pray. Father, thank you for this day, Lord, and your word. Give us revelation. And Father God, may it penetrate our heart and our mind, Lord, and our soul and our spirit and our flesh and every part of us. Because your word never returns void. Speak to us, Lord. Give us revelation in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Right here at 6:31, it says, and he said unto them, come you yourselves apart into a desert place and rest a while. We see here that Jesus was entering into his ministry, and he taught his disciples how to do ministry. And his disciples went out, and it says that they healed the sick and they cast out devils. And earlier in this chapter, if you read it, but there's a time for rest. You know, after you do a work, amen. You know, after you do something for God.
Come on.
That's the key. After you do something for God. And you know what? This is the only time really that Jesus said that to his disciples throughout, you know, pretty much the New Testament here. And he didn't really talk much about resting. You know, there's another place he does mention it, but a few places actually, but it's not pertaining to that type of a rest. You know, it's a physical rest, you know, where even spiritual, if you will, you know, because there's a time where if you're a laborer in the kingdom, and if you that do anything for God, if you do it a lot, you know, there's a time you feel like you need rest, you know, and it's okay. There's nothing wrong with taking a vacation. I know I look like I just got back from Hawaii, but I might be resting in the spirit, but there's a time when you need a vacation, and that's okay. There's a time when you need some time off, you know. But I don't believe that we should be off too long. It says right there, for a while, right? It says, and rest for a while. Sometimes some people take rest too long. Sometimes people take working for the kingdom of God a retirement. You don't see them no more, you know. I've been, you know, serving God for some time, and I've had co-laborers that have worked with me and beside me, and now I can't, like, they're nowhere to be found, you know, because they took that rest, and they took a vacation, and they took a retirement, so to speak. And I don't believe that we, as men of God, when there's a work to be done, that we should be so restful that we are slothful. We become slumberish. And this is where I believe the church in general, is at. You know, they're in a state of sleepiness, lethargy, sluggish, of bewilderment, of coldness, depassion, apathy, a lack of interest or concern for others, absence of compassion, wax hearted. I believe that we are seeing in these last days, as the coming of the Lord approaches, that most of his people are at a place of religiosity, a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. Paul wrote Timothy, and he said this is going to come to pass. And as Jesus is about to open up them doors and sound the trumpet, church is taking a break. Men of God are not doing what they're called to do when time for devotion, time for hobby, or time for work in the kingdom of God. Some men are not to be found. They're not dressed for battle. They're not dressed for being a worker in the kingdom of God. They're not dressed to carry their cross and deny themselves and follow me as the Lord has said. We don't hear much preaching of that because a lot of people will get discouraged and leave. And so people have itching ears, looking for doctrines that will itch their ears and tickle their ears, looking for churches that have a country club, so to speak, and a fellowship more than a workship, a workmanship.
Tell like it is.
Uh-huh.
Come on. Tell the truth.
Tell it.
Amen.
I come today to tell you what I'm telling you because the Lord speaks to me this way. Not, I practice what I preach. I'm not just up here saying things, and I'm not afraid to say it. Because the Lord has mandated us as men of God, not just me, to occupy till I come. Hey!
Come on!
That means get a job. Occupy. That doesn't mean just going to go fill out an application at McDonald's or Lockheed, but to work for his kingdom. For we are his workmen. Workmanship created in Christ Jesus unto good works. There is a job that needs to be done. There's souls that need to be saved.
Amen.
And God is raising an army, and we go forth a mighty army to defeat the enemy. And a lot of times we can't go forth because we are barely making it ourselves. We are living a life of defeat rather than victory, rather than being more than conquerors through Christ who loved us. We are not putting on the armor of God, so therefore there's condemnation and conviction, and we don't feel right to do what God has called us to do. God has not called us to a spirit of slumber. Amen. It says, awake to righteousness and sin not. Uh-huh.
Amen.
The church is a sleeping giant. If they only knew who we were, if we only knew who we were,
come on.
The power that we have within us, what we're called to do, rather than just be a bless me, us four, no more. Gimme. My name is Jimmy. God has called you to be blessed, to be a blessing. God has given you knowledge and truth to share it. God has reconciled you that you might reconcile men back unto him. Amen. He's given you a ministry, each and every individual, a ministry. Whether you're an evangelist or not, you are called to evangelize. Amen. And go out and preach the gospel to every creature. He's given you a ministry of reconciliation. 2 Corinthians 5:18, 19. He's called us to minister to men because we are the light of the world.
Amen.
A city on a hill that needs not to be hid.
Come on,
amen. Come on. We are to show forth the beatitudes in our life. Humbleness. Amen.
Jesus.
Peacemakers. For they shall be called the children of God. Amen.
Amen.
The merciful shall obtain mercy. Because you give mercy. You have given mercy.
Amen.
A lot of times we hold grudges and we can't even and do what God has called us to do and let our light shine because we hold something towards another brother that has offended us in some way, some pastor or some teacher or some family member or something of the past. You got to let it go because you've been forgiven. And as if you've been forgiven, forgive others, the scripture says. How can you move the mountain when you stand praying? Jesus said, if you haven't forgiven others, I can't forgive you. We don't read that part. We just read the part before that. Because all we were looking out was for our own interest. Timothy said, and God told Paul told Timothy in the last days, men will be lovers of themselves and lovers of pleasure more than of God. Jesus said in Matthew 24:12, because iniquity love, the love of many will wax cold. In Matthew 25:5, the bridegroom waited and they slumbered and slept. Jesus hasn't came for a long time, so the church slumbered and slept. There was five wise and five foolish. The wise woke up. Hello. Some of you need to wise up and wake up and put some oil in your lamp. Amen. Some of that anointing. Amen. In your life. And let your lamp light up. Amen. Your light shine. Amen. You need to light up and live holy because he is holy.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. You know, we hear about grace and the righteousness of God a lot today. And everybody's comfortable with that message and don't do nothing. The church needs to wake up and realize, why are we righteous? Why are we holy? He's made us holy in His sight. The Bible says that we are kings and priests unto our God. Amen. He has made us kings and priests. I know you don't feel like one, and I know you don't look like one, but the Bible says you are one, so therefore you got to believe what the Word of God says, not how you feel or how you look. Amen. Because we walk by faith and by sight. You got to believe the Word of God, who God calls you to be. Amen. And speak that over yourself, even though you may not feel like it. Because God, that's the way God moves. He calls those things that aren't as though they were. Just like He called Abraham, amen. From Abram, father, to Abraham, father of many nations. Abraham had no sons until He called him that. And God calls you the righteousness of God. Amen. To him that knew no sin became sin for us, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Not in you. It's not by your good works, but it's by what Jesus did on that cross. When God looks at you, He sees a robe of righteousness. He sees a righteous man of God. Amen? Even though you missed the mark. We all missed the mark, but we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus, the righteous one. Hallelujah. Because we all missed the mark. Amen? But that doesn't mean you give up. That doesn't mean you have condemnation. That doesn't mean you draw back. Amen. Because we are not, as Paul said, of them that draw back. But we are them unto the saving of the soul. Uh-huh. We are not called unto perdition of waste. Amen. God called us for a purpose. Amen. To bring Him glory and to bring Him pleasure. Amen. God called us so we can have eternal life and life abundantly. Jesus said, the devil comes to kill, steal, and destroy, but I come to give you life and life abundantly. Amen. What I'm saying is what I believe. I'm not just out here just hot air. This is what I live. This is what I believe for 35 years now. And glory to God. He keeps me. Amen. He'll keep you. If you keep His word,
that's right.
Jesus said, if you keep my word, I will keep you from the hour of temptation that will come upon this earth and try them. He said, let no man therefore take your crown.
Come on.
Mm-hmm. The crown of life, the crown of righteousness. Amen. The decision is yours. God isn't going to force you. God isn't making robots. God didn't just call some. He called everybody, but everybody's not answering the call. Hello, somebody. Hey! I do that because some of y'all look like you're sleeping. Occupy till I come. Be not weary in well-doing, for you shall reap if you faint not. Amen. Don't expect a harvest if there's no laboring. Don't expect a harvest if you haven't planted no seed. Don't expect to pluck the crop if you haven't planted anything in the kingdom of God. Whatever a man sows, that he shall also reap. If he sows to his flesh, he shall reap corruption. But if he sows to the Spirit, he shall reap everlasting life.
Amen. Come on.
Amen. It is about reaping and sowing. As long as the earth remains, the Bible says that in Genesis chapter 6, there shall be seed time and harvest. How many know the earth is still here? I know it is because you're walking on something. And seed time and harvest is still in effect. No deposit, no return. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Some of you worry about your clothes, your finances, your bills paid. Amen. Because you're not seeking God first and trusting God. But if you trust God, amen. Yeah, I'm here as a witness that He will meet every need according to His glories and riches in Christ Jesus. My God supplies all my needs, not some of them.
Come on, Pastor.
We got to believe Him and trust Him and believe what the Word says and not be moved by our circumstances, but stand on the sure foundation, amen, which is an anchor for your soul,
amen.
The Word of God.
Praise
amen.
Amen.
Glory. Let's go to Matthew 11. Matthew 11:28. Down, and it says, "Come unto me, all you that are that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am weak and lowly, and you shall find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light." Amen. It's only hard to serve God when you don't really serve Him. Hello. When you really don't serve Him. Amen. When you carry your own yokes, life gets hard. But when you start doing what God called you to do, He said, "My yoke is easy and my burden is light." A lot of times we don't come unto Him with the full knowledge of what He did on that cross. Amen. What He did on that cross, He said, "It is finished." You don't have to work for your salvation. All you got to do is believe it. Amen. For by faith are you saved through grace. It is a gift of God, not of yourselves. So you can find rest in that. You can find rest in that. And when you find rest in that, you will do something for the kingdom of God. Because His yoke is easy and His burden is light. You will do something for Him because out of a attitude of gratitude, appreciation, of worship, of honor, of loyalty, of commitment and devotion to the one, the King that you serve. A lot of times we don't have gratitude. One of the definitions of grace, for you saved by grace, is gratitude. We don't understand grace fully to its core. We are all learning. But grace means gratitude. Grace means divine influence upon the heart and the reflection in one's life. Are you divinely influenced by God to do His will? Understand what grace really means, not just unmerited favor. We don't deserve it, none of us. And He gives it to us anyways. But don't take advantage of that. For we are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works. Amen? Amen. To walk in them. To live in them. Amen?
Amen?
So we find rest for our souls in the finished work of Christ. Look at Acts 2. Acts 2. 26 and 27. It says, "Therefore did my heart rejoice, and my tongue was glad. Moreover, also my flesh shall rest in hope. Because thou wilt not leave my soul in hell, neither wilt thou suffer thine Holy One to see corruption." This is talking about Jesus. We're seeing here that David had a revelation, and it was prophetic. And he was talking about Jesus. When he went to hell, he was not going to be left there. Amen? And it says that He says that his flesh will rest and hold. The word right there, rest, means to remain.
Amen.
Your flesh someday will go to the dust if the Lord don't come back. But because Jesus defeated death and corruption in the flesh, your flesh could find rest and hope in what Jesus did on the finished work.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. We don't sorrow like others, the scripture says. Amen.
Amen.
Who having no hope?
Come on now. Amen.
But we have a hope.
Yes.
If Christ died again and rose up again, so shall we, the scripture says.
Yes.
And our flesh should have rest in that. Not just our spirit. Because to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord.
Amen.
But our flesh will die. But one day, hallelujah, it will come back to life. Because Jesus was the first fruits of them that slept. He never refers death unto death, but to sleep. When Lazarus died, he said, "He is not dead, but he sleepeth, and I'm going to go wake him up." Because with God, death is only temporary. That's why it's sleep.
Yeah.
And hallelujah. He's going to wake you up one day. He's going to wake my grandparents up one day. Amen. He's going to wake up Gilbert one day. Amen. My uncle. He's going to wake up all my family members that went before me. My mom. Amen. My grandfather. Hallelujah. Because all in Arnold, all my family is getting saved. Amen. Because we have a covenant. Amen. You have a covenant too, and I believe it. The scripture says, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you shall be saved, and your whole household. Amen. My grandfather was a pioneer with this church right here, La Trinidad. David's grandfather and him, my grandmother and my grandfather were maid of honor and best man in their way. And in the 1926 or 27, when they started this church, he started it with them. And my grandfather has a covenant with his kids, his grandchildren. His whole household is going to be saved if you believe. Amen. This is a promise for you, for your children and your children's children. Amen. Hallelujah. Don't be moved. They're all coming in. I don't care if it's at the deathbed. I don't care if it's at their deathbed, I said. They're coming in. Because I've seen some of them just waited till that point.
Amen. Me too.
But they came in.
Amen.
They came in. Uh-huh. And you just got to believe that. And you just got to continue not just get discouraged. You got to be that light. You got to be that example before your family member.
Amen.
You got to let that light shine. Amen. And so they can have hope like you have hope. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Let's go to Zephaniah 3:17.
Preach!
Zephaniah. Somewhere in the Old Testament, somebody said. Give me a page number. I have that Bible. And my book is 994. Chapter 3. I'll tell you right now. Again, I already said, but hold on. You wanna get ahead of me, I know. But listen, this chapter right here, this verse right here, I made an announcement of 3 or 4 weeks ago. My brother-in-law passed away, Pastor Randy. And he came and preached here about a year ago. And he passed away with cancer, you know. But he never gave up. He has 5 kids, and they all love the Lord. From 9 years old to 21. They all love the Lord. When I went over there before he passed away on his birthday. February 24th or something like that. And I went over there, it was Friday night, and I was talking to them in the room, and he was bedridden, and the man of God, he fought the fight to the end. And so the Lord gave me this verse. He's been giving me this verse to speak it over to people. And he gave it, that day, he was the first one, he gave it to me to give to him, and I told him, I said, let me read it. 3:17 says, the Lord thy God is in the midst of thee, is mighty. He will save, he will rejoice over thee with joy. He will rest in his love. He will joy over thee with singing. And I told him this scripture, I said, God rests in his love over you. He's mighty to save over you and your kids, because you have not given up. And he says that he will sing over you. And another translation says he will dance over you.
Amen.
In his love. That's a beautiful thing. I want you to know that God does the same thing for you. Uh-huh.
Amen.
He does the same thing for us. He sings over us. Hallelujah. And I want you to know why he sings over us and how he can sing over us even though you're not pretty. Mm-hmm. Right there it says he will rest in his love. Mm-hmm. And the reason why God can rest in his love for 4,000 years from Adam all the way to Jesus, the fulfillment of love has not came into his flourishing. Jesus was the ultimate love. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. That whoever believes in him will not perish but have everlasting life. Jesus said, no greater love has a man than this, that he would lay down his life for his friends. Jesus filled that to the core. He laid down his life for his 12, and not only for his 12, but for the whole world, for you and me.
Amen.
Amen. And so we see Zephaniah here as a prophet prophesying of the future, that God will rest in his love over Israel, but not only Israel, to every mankind. Because what Jesus of the finished work on that cross, he could rest in his love. And he could dance over you, not because you're a good guy, but because his blood, hallelujah, he could sing over you, hallelujah. He could call you the righteousness of God in him.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And he could rest in his love. God's been working for 4,000 years with men before Jesus. And Jesus, when he died on the cross, said, it is finished! With a shout of victory. That was a different shout right there. Jesus praised God on that cross.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And said, it is finished.
Amen.
Because you don't have to work for your salvation, but you just come unto him and find rest for your souls. And now he could rest in his love. And he could dance and sing over you. Hallelujah. Some of you have not even experienced that yet, that his love. Some of you have not experienced his peace and his salvation in your life. Hallelujah.
That you would bear my cross.